Now, I guess adventurer isn't your typical career title in HR. But then again, I've never followed the conventional path to success. I'm only 25. I'm not a businessman. And I've failed every big mountain I've tried to climb. And yet this year, we've been forced to think differently, to redefine success. We're often told that success is reaching the top of the mountain. When this year we've all had practice on expedition, we've all been stuck at base camp. And many of us have spent the last few months stuck behind four walls. We haven't seen our family, we've been working at home, and we haven't quite known when this is going to end. And when surrounded by all this bad news and uncertainty, it will be very easy for us just to sit in base camp and to wait for things to go back to normal. But actually, we can't afford to sit there and wait. We've all been stuck on the same mountain, but not everybody is a Sherpa. Some will have found it harder than others. And most businesses have put mental health and well-being at the top of their agenda. And rightly so. Because in 2018 and 19, stress, anxiety, and depression was responsible for more than half of all sick days. And we can only imagine what those figures are going to be this year. So clearly, we can't afford to do nothing. Now, everybody's talking about that word. It's resilience. Now, the problem is resilience means something different to each and every one of us. Why bounce back when we can bounce forwards? Well, today I'm going to be sharing what I've learned about resilience from two disasters on Mount Everest to help us redefine success, to keep moving forwards and take that step into the unknown, even when we can't see the top of the mountain. But we aren't born with a fixed amount of resilience. So first, I want to tell you a story. Because I was never your traditional candidate for climbing Everest. I had a great start in life. My parents gave me everything I needed. But when I was about 9 years old, things became a lot more challenging. I was diagnosed with a malform of epilepsy, which shattered my confidence. It left me suffering with anxiety and panic attacks, and it left me a nervous wreck. Like many young people, I was badly bullied throughout my entire time at school. It left me with no confidence and feeling worthless, just because I was different. I was hopeless at sport, and here's the weird thing. I've had a stammer in my speech ever since I've been able to speak. It comes and goes when it likes. It just turns up to social events with no real purpose but to get on your nerves, a bit like a wasp. And it can be so bad that I've smashed up phones at home in the frustration of being unable to say my own name. How do you forget to say your own name? And yet even today, or at least before COVID, I could be on a train to go and speak to hundreds of people and not be able to ask for a train ticket. But put all these things together, and I believed that I was born to fail. I was stuck in this victim mindset. But luckily, it didn't have to be that way. Now, 10 years ago, 14 years old, I was on my first walk in the mountains of the Lake District, UK. And that blew my mind, because suddenly I'm surrounded by the mountains, the hills, inspiring me to dream bigger than ever before. It inspired a curiosity to question all those limits and doubts that we all put on ourselves and that other people put on us. At some point, I asked myself, where is Mount Everest? And of course, being a millennial, I came home, I went on Google, I became captivated by the idea of climbing the world's highest peak. That for me was my idea of success. But we all have our own Everest. So what could that mean for you? Now, the next thing I knew, I was hanging 7,000 feet in the air. I was on holiday in Turkey when I tried something called paragliding, quite an extreme sport, and I'd never been so scared in my life. But taking that leap out of my comfort zone changed my life because it taught me that foundation of resilience, that we can't always choose our challenges, but we can choose our response. And how true has that been in these recent challenging months? And with that in mind, with that growth mindset, I wanted to keep on challenging myself, to keep on proving myself wrong and building this new experience. And I've been worrying my poor parents sick ever since. But from there, over the next 4 years, I put those steps in place to make this Everest goal a reality. Training in the UK, climbing in Scotland, in the Alps, Mont Blanc, the Himalayas, getting the experience that I needed. But getting a place on an Everest expedition was going to cost about £35,000. My parents weren't going to sign me a cheque. My job washing pots in a local restaurant wasn't going to pay for it. So I was going to have to find a way or make one. Now, corporate sponsorship was my only real option. But it was my first mentor, Chris, who said to me, "You don't need to know all the steps. You've just got to start, then find the way." And the tipping point came when the fear of not trying and not knowing what was possible became bigger than the fear of failure or potential failure. And to cut the long story short, in 2014, at 18, I flew out to Nepal on my first Everest expedition. Our team spent 3 weeks just walking into base camp, looking up at the mountains around us, thinking, if I feel like this down here, how on earth am I going to climb that? Thing is, we weren't. A day before we arrived at base camp, a huge avalanche killed 16 climbing Sherpas. We had to pack up and leave without stepping a single foot on Everest. Now, I was naive enough to declare that failure wasn't an option. But how wrong I was. The mountain doesn't give a damn how hard we've worked, how much we've invested, and COVID is probably going to treat us the same way. The issue is that we train for success, but we don't usually train for failure. And so we're following this programmed exact route to the top, which only leaves us fragile to these inevitable challenges that life brings. But then I realized that actually failure was purely down to me and how I responded. But in 2015, we went back to Everest. We left base camp for camp one. We're moving through the Khumbu Icefall ourselves, which is the most dangerous part of the entire route. You're walking across these crevasses, hundreds of feet deep, on a stepladder held together by rope. And then we've got towers of ice, taller than a house, that can topple at any moment. We have to move through as fast as we possibly can. But our certainty is no bigger than about 2 feet in front of us. And so the hardest part is always taking that first step into the unknown. Our brains prefer a more predictable environment. We don't like uncertainty. And then in times like these, like a pandemic, which most of us have never experienced before, we naturally replace all these unknowns with old data and assumptions, which are generally a lot worse than the reality. And of course, it was hard to forget what had happened the year before. But to keep moving forwards, we've got to replace that old data with a curiosity about what could be across the ladder, even if that means just taking one small step at a time. But altitude takes no prisoners. Doesn't matter how young you are, how fit you are up there. You know, you have good days and bad days, and that day it felt like I'd never been on a mountain in my life. And when you're exhausted The Sherpas come flying past you in their sandals carrying 50 kilos. Superhumanly strong. We had a Sherpa on our team called Padawa, who'd summited Everest 21 times. But there's no use trying to keep up with everybody else and getting distracted when everybody's scrambling around, because otherwise we're just going to miss what's right in front of us. And that day, I was so exhausted that I didn't actually feel the ground shaking. I didn't feel the earthquake that's just hit Nepal and taken over 9,000 lives. I just remember this huge crack above my head, the sound of ice breaking off the mountain, and this distant primal roar of an avalanche coming straight for us. Panic set in. I've got to move. I set off as fast as I could, this noise getting louder and faster all the time. And as I kept stopping to catch my breath, I assumed that it should have hit me by now. I must be safe. And just when I thought we'd escaped, the air pressure changed and it hit me with this whack like a snow cannon. Threw me off my feet, suffocating, freezing cold air all around me. For the first time in my life at 19, I thought, this is it. Game over. This wasn't meant to happen. But miraculously, the debris never came, and we'd escaped pretty much unharmed. But now our team of 12 are trapped at Camp 1, 6,000 meters, higher than the top of Kilimanjaro. The route down to base camp had gone. We've got food for a day. We're told we could be there for a week. And every half an hour, we've got aftershocks and avalanches hitting us from both sides. And all we can do is sit there, stay hydrated, stay fueled, and look after each other. But at the time, we had no idea that actually we were in the safest place of all. Base camp down below had been hit by a much bigger avalanche, triggered by the earthquake. Our home on the mountain had gone. And it was like a plane crash. You know, we didn't know where to start. But sadly, three of our team had gone with it. The last time we'd see Pasang Temba, Kumar and Tenzing was breakfast that morning. Everybody assumes that staying at base camp is the safest place to be. But in reality, had we not left base camp that morning, then we most likely wouldn't be here now. Just like staying in our comfort zones kills our potential, our ability to achieve what's truly possible. And after Everest, I came home asking, why them? Why not me? Dealing with this guilt and this loss of purpose and depression. And it's in these unusual experiences that I think this tool by the great Stephen Covey is something we can all relate to. Because the sooner we can focus our energy on the things in our circle of influence, our circle of control, however big or small that could be, the sooner we can make that transition, we can take that step forwards out of the disaster zone. And we've seen that recently, how fast the world is moving. We're doing things in days or weeks that would normally take months or years. I mean, even vaccines, for one example. Now, in this personal experience, you know, I didn't realize this had just opened up even more opportunities, like fundraising for the earthquake victims, doing more challenges, writing my first books, speaking and sharing my story like I am now. None of these things that I ever actually planned for or expected. And the year after, I went back to try and climb the sixth highest peak in the world, Choa Yu in Tibet. But this time, before we even reached base camp, I was very nearly evacuated with altitude sickness. I was rushed down to a lower altitude to recover. That night, our base camp manager, Henry, came in to check on me. But when I couldn't respond, when I couldn't speak, he rushed in a panic, checking me for the signs of high altitude cerebral edema, which is a bit like a stroke. and had to assure him that it wasn't cerebral edema. It was just my stammer. But that night, I was convinced. I was making all these assumptions that I was going home. It was all over. And what a waste of energy that was. Because 2 weeks later, I was joining the rest of the team at Camp 2, heading on our summit push. That night, we headed out into the darkness. But I quickly couldn't walk in a straight line. I was coming down with possible cerebral edema, which can be fatal. So my summit attempt was off. But as I lay there in my tent at 23,000 feet, minus 23 degrees Celsius, my tent mate Dan was snowblind, another teammate Billy had frostnip in her fingers, and I was throwing up all over the tent. I started to really ask myself, why am I really here? Am I really making my biggest difference? Was I ever going to be truly happy in reaching the top? Or was I always going to need that next goal? But it's so easy to get stuck in that sunken cost fallacy, where we keep on doing what we've always done just because it's easier than change. Until times like this, when we have no choice but to stop, to take stock, to reevaluate. And it was my old coach, John Thompson, a brigadier in the army, who often said, we need to focus on the main effort. And you know, I've been so focused on reaching the summit that I'd actually missed the journey to get there. I'd forgotten why I started and I'd gone completely off course. So it's okay for the mountain to change. The hardest part is being willing to accept that. So I started to look a bit closer to home. And the following year began another challenge, climbing to the highest points of all 100 UK county tops in the UK. Cycling, walking and running over 5,000 miles in 72 days. Now this challenge raised over £25,000 for charity, but more importantly, people were coming out joining me this time, walking, running with me, climbing their own mountains, achieving something in the process. And that, for me, created something so much bigger and more rewarding than simply reaching the top of the mountain and climbing down again, because it kept that journey going. And I wanted to get that message out there. But for me, the biggest challenge has been mental health. And what really struck me is it took me longer to get support for that than it did to cycle 5,000 miles around the UK, which simply isn't good enough. Now, this year we've had a perfect storm for mental health, especially in the workplace, with the bereavement, the isolation, the trauma, anxiety, job losses, the list goes on. Now, for me personally, spending time outdoors, being active, has helped me to manage those peaks and troughs. I think it's the most powerful tool that we have. So earlier this year, me and my mentor, Chris, started a new charity called Mind Over Mountains, which is all about restoring mental health through outdoor experiences. We combine walking in the hills with coaching and mindfulness and counseling, inspirational speakers, and just giving people that space, confidential space, to walk and talk, to reconnect, to rebuild their resilience. Of course, COVID has given us lots of challenges, but with a name like that, we had to find a way around it. However, we all know the mountains don't always look like this, blue skies and sunshine. This was a bit more typical. We had a storm warning. We couldn't see a thing. It was raining for the entire day. We were wringing the water out of our gloves and singing to cheer the spirits. But there's nothing a flask of hot chocolate can't fix. And I think it's these moments when we're out on the edge, when we're walking across that stepladder, when everything seems to be at risk or unheard of, that we need that safety net around us. We need to trust those people around us too. And that connection is going to be so important in these months ahead. We need to trust the process, even if it's just taking one small step at a time. And I'd just like to finish with a quote, which I think we can all relate to. And in these radical times, we have this opportunity for radical growth, even if we can't quite see it. We're not going to find it if we're sat at base camp in our comfort zones, afraid of failure. In fact, it was two disasters on Everest that actually helped me to define what success really meant for me. And I found that success is about the process, not just the outcome. It's about how we respond and how we keep moving forwards through the inevitable adversity that comes. Now, you probably want to know, would I go back to Everest? But I've got a question first for you. How can we encourage our teams to take that first step into the unknown, to embrace the ambiguity? Instead of asking, what could go wrong? Let's ask, what could we risk if we stay at base camp? And I'd love to help them take that first step. So how can I help you? Well, maybe your team might benefit from a program in Mind Over Mountains, and to get your team back into nature to reconnect with themselves and each other. And in the meantime, please subscribe to my newsletter if you scan the QR code on the screen, and I'll send you my top tips for boosting, you know, workplace well-being and resilience, which you can share with all your colleagues to try and manage, especially all these challenges of working from home. If that doesn't work, please feel free to contact me on social media, on my website, or connect with me on LinkedIn, and I'd be happy to send them there as well. I'd love to keep this, this chat going and share our ideas. Because there's only so much that we can share in 20 minutes. But in the meantime, I look forward to hearing from you. Thank you for having me, and I hope you enjoy the rest of a fantastic conference ahead. Stay safe, and I look forward to seeing you soon. Thank you.
What an exceptional journey, Alex. Thank you very much for this insightful presentation. Actually, I'd like to keep you on to talk with me about the importance of supporting employees and how can C-level help out his collaborators to give them the best weapons in their professional and personal path journey. So maybe my first question to you would be, could you share what you haven't actually disclosed in your presentation, in your keynote? What are the tips, what would you like to add about your personal background, your personal journey that could inspire the audience?
I think there's a lot more I could share in that, Jonathan. I think some of the key parts that I've learned have really been about having that support team, having great mentors, having coaches, and not being afraid to ask for help. I think we all relate to others in various ways. You know, we've all had goals, we all have dreams, and we all like to help others achieve that. And I wouldn't have got to where I am today without being willing to ask for that. And I think if you have confidence in your own vision, people connect with that, people see that, and they want to give you the tools to make that a reality. And I've seen the way people respond to crisis. You know, on Everest, it was our expedition leader who had obviously not experienced a disaster quite like this. You know, he'd never been in an avalanche on Everest before. But actually, his honesty only helped us to create that trust. You know, he didn't claim to know anything that he didn't. He came into our tents that night as we were stuck at Camp One and said, you know, stay fueled, stay hydrated, keep the stove on. We don't know how long it's going to take, you know, but he didn't promise anything. He just said it as it was. And I think that honesty, that ability to be, you know, to be vulnerable, to share how we're feeling with everybody in the business, with everybody in the team, I think made that situation a lot more bearable. Otherwise, we start creating all these scenarios and this old data. And I think as well, when things have gone wrong, I've always gone back to my mentors, my coaches, and they've always put me back on track. You know, sometimes we need that person who's not connected to the mission to see things from a different angle and just to give us that steer. And that journey has been incredibly rewarding because me and Chris, who was my very first mentor 8 years ago, is now a co-director, you know, of the charity. We're working on that together and we've gone along that journey. If I can add maybe a foot tip, it's to, I think, always to be true to yourself. You know, I touched on this before about, you know, knowing the main efforts. But I think if we're not being true to ourselves, then success is never sustainable. You know, if we're trying to prove things wrong to other people, then we've kind of failed by default. And I think knowing yourself, being able to ask, why am I doing this? To have that purpose, to have that reason to fight back, I think for me has been the most powerful weapon in tough times. You know, and I think the pandemic in particular has been challenging for me for sure. But the tools that I've gained from my expeditions have helped me to make the best of it. And naturally, at the start of lockdown, I sat down and I wrote down all the ways that I could make the best of the situation. How could I use my skills and experience to help others? And that has turned it into another challenge rather than a problem. So I think that's a few tips into one there. But mostly it's about knowing yourself, knowing why you're doing something and having that purpose. I think purpose is everything, whether that's a mental health challenge, whether that's an avalanche, or whether it's a pandemic, or even just a difficult time in our businesses. So know your why and tell everybody what that why is.
All right. Maybe a personal question, if I may. You mentioned that you were bullied at school. How did you cope with that? I mean, at the time, and now, have you seen, came across some of the bulliers, and you know, how did you actually react today, knowing that you've been through almost near-death experience in this avalanche and so on, and you've learned so much. I'm really impressed because you're only 25 and you're very mature in your speech, and you seem to be now more confident also. How did you cope at the time, and how do you reflect on that now?
For sure. I think it's a big problem, not only at school, but even in the workplace. And I'm sure, you know, it's something that we've all experienced, which is a shame. At the time, as a young person, you know, I was very reactive, maybe didn't respond in the most mature way, you know, and it really shattered my confidence. But it took age and maturity to be able to reflect on that and to realize that actually none of these things really mattered. And I guess at the time I coped by finding a way to make myself different, and the outdoors challenges was that. You know, I found that escape. I found somewhere where my confidence wasn't dependent on other people. It was dependent on me and the environment and the challenges. But over time, that need to prove anything went away. You know, I didn't need to prove anything anymore. It wasn't about them. It was about me versus my own limits and expectations. So I think the outdoors was key to that, but it's finding what that could be for us, you know, finding that identity. I think today it's a really good question that I have occasionally seen the people that bullied me, and most of them have gone on to succeed and find themselves. You know, I think people bully because they're not happy about something in themselves. Some of them have stayed where I thought they might be. But even so, it's, you know, what all these experiences have taught me, like the avalanche, is what really matters, you know, and hopefully that's something that we can all take from the pandemic, is what really matters, you know, and nobody can make us feel anything about ourselves. And I guess I'd be really interested to know, in your experience as well, is how that's managed as a team, you know, how you would approach that, perhaps if you experience something like that in a business team where there's lots of people with different opinions as well.
Yeah. So, thanks for asking. It is challenging. You got to take into consideration personality, different personalities. We've got a team of 35 today, and I must say that, you know, my personal background, I did a lot of rugby when I was younger, and you know, it's by, I think by design, something that is a teamwork. So there's risk at rugby, because rugby playing is combat sport. So there's indeed something that is part of the thrill of rugby. Is there's going to be risk, and a risk for your own body, right? But you also have to work as a team, and to make sure that your teammates are safe, and that the goal is also to have the ball and to score, right? So there's a purpose. And I think that that is the key element, to give a purpose, to set an objective, to define targets that are reachable, that people can actually see in your leadership that you know what you're doing, you know what where you're going, and inspire them by, you know, simple things. Just telling them, I understand what your personal background might be. I'm not going to go into personal considerations. That's not part of my job. I'm not a psychiatrist. I'm not a psychologist. But still, you've got to make sure that there is a connection. It's about the human part of each of and every one of us. So the idea there is, I think, the key element is to make sure you listen to the people, take into consideration who they are, what their personal path is, and where you can actually lead them to. And the crisis has been interesting in that sense, because there's different ways of reacting. I saw people who were panicking, you know, because it's unknown, it's stressful, obviously, for everyone. And some people just get freaked out, and others kind of potentially or probably more resilient in that sense, and say, well, whatever happens, I'm going to keep on going, and that's it. Actually, still very personal, but I went through in my professional path, the very first milestone was an accident, a chemical plant in Toulouse, where I was living at the time in the southwest of France, exploded. And there were tens of people who died, hundreds and thousands of wounded. And actually, I wasn't directly impacted in the sense that I wasn't harmed, but the house where I was living, all the windows were blown away and things like that. So it's not as threatening and scary as what you've been through, but it's something that you actually remember, because it's impactful on you. And I met then the CEO of the company I wasn't supposed to work for, but that was because of this accident. In the firm where they were, all the windows, the doors were blown away, and they had computers, they had phones and stuff like that. So they were hoping to secure the building, and they asked me and a few friends like that to stay over. You know, the rugby guys, they're, you know, not me, but the big blokes who came up, and we just were there to make sure that no one was going to steal all the computers and stuff like that. So that was fun. And actually, I met this guy, and we had a chat, and he said, are you going, what is your purpose? What are you intending to do in your professional and personal life? And I was quite astonished that he was asking about my personal goals, not only the professional. I said, I'm going to work for Airbus. You know, in Toulouse, it's huge, massive. Airbus is the biggest company in Toulouse, and you know, it's really exciting, and I was going to join them. And in fact, he said, you know, you should consider the digital and the telecom industry. This is probably more in line with what your inspiration is. And I trusted him, and in fact, I joined the team, and here I am almost 20 years later. I started as an employee in an industry I didn't know, and then I joined my my current business partners almost 10 years later. So I've been in Luxembourg for 10 years, and that's it. You'd never know what's going to be next. So coming back to the team in this specific condition and days where crisis, the pandemic and so on, but not only that, unemployment, all the tension around the world, you know, the leaders that are themselves a bit lost, they seem to be lost. It's, I think, creating a lot of anxiety. And dealing with this anxiety is the key. So if you can find people who give you the keys to deal with your personal anxieties, I think that's the interesting part. So listening to others is clearly the key.
Definitely. Yeah. And I think accepting that, you know, everybody is on their own mountain. It looks different for everybody. And not trying to fix that, just trying to listen is actually often a lot harder than to speak and to try and find the answer. What you said there before was, I think, was really key about, you know, you never know what's next, what's around the corner. And 10 years ago on that mountain in the Lake District, I would never have imagined that I would be speaking with a stammer to all of you this morning. So I think it's keeping an open mind, but you need to have some kind of compass. You've got to have some idea of where you're going. Otherwise, you're likely to take the line of least resistance. And I feel very grateful for this adversity, you know, the avalanches, the 2 years of what you could call bad luck, because ultimately they've sent me on the path that I'm on now. And interestingly, not on the Airbus, you know, as Fermi mentioned, their plant in Chester wasn't far from my house as a child, and the Airbus was, you know, flying over most days. And before I found the outdoors, being a pilot was my ambition. But ultimately, actually, if that hadn't gone so wrong on Everest, I probably would have gone down the more conventional route. And that wasn't really me. You know, I've always been different and wanted to go off the beaten track. But only by proving that with experience can we build our own confidence, because life will give us 100 reasons not to do it. People will doubt us, and people doubted me for sure. But in some ways, back to your point before about all the bullying, the bullies made me not necessarily stubborn, but very single-minded and able to switch off from things that I didn't think were going to serve me. So I'm very grateful to them for that.
Yeah, wonderful. Alex, thank you ever so much. It was really a great pleasure for me. And I must say that I'm really impressed by who you are, what you've done, what you've achieved up to now. And I'm sure there's going to be much more. And I wish you best of luck for your next endeavors. Thanks very much, Alex. We're going to have a break now, and we'll see you in a few minutes. Thanks a lot.
Thanks all. See you again. Have a great day.